Nice glasses, Sheila.
Thank you. Well, Ellen Rosenfield gave them to me this time last year before our last rehearsal.
Perfect.
Perfect. I think a few other BCCOers. Mary, don't you have a pair? And Jared, oh, Jared has his hat on. Hi, Jared.
Hey, hey.
I have a caroler. Well, she's singing carols.
What did you say? Well, I'm not dead yet.
Hey, Sarah, can you throw me Santa?
Hmm?
I have a Santa around here somewhere.
What do you want?
Santa.
Oh, Phyllis got a little note. What is
it? Christmas damn it. Yeah,
they call them damn it dolls, but I think they call them trolls now.
Yeah.
They do, I know. But they were made by a company, by the man who invented it was named Dam, so that's why they're Dammits. So
oh, okay. Yeah. Yeah, that's a nice little story.
Hey, everybody.
It
is 7 o'clock.
Oh, my goodness.
I love seeing all the decorations and everything.
Oh.
That's really fantastic. This is going to be a fun, relaxed way of finishing off this semester. And I'll let you know some of our things. We have this whole stocking row of all the kids and all that kind of stuff. And then we also got a new tree today because something happened with our old tree and it just didn't take up any water and it just died. We didn't want to try to make it last until Christmas and then throw it out. And so we decided just today to get a new one and have it last, you know, through at least to the new year and everything. So I think that should be a lot of fun. But speaking of, I think that it might be fun while we're getting situated to talk a little bit about what's going to happen next year. And so I have a little thing to do right before we get into the festivities and to the, how do I do this? Before we get into some of our warm-ups and to the running of the foray and everything. Let's see, I have to share first then. Okay. Great. So I just want to sort of review how the fall and summer, how we've been thinking about it, because as you know, this has been something that has been improvisatory for us. And we're sort of still feeling out how things are working, like many orchestras and choruses all around the world, trying to figure out what's the best way to do rehearsals and whatnot. So there's sort of a review of fall and summer and the plan for the spring semester. So, you know, review in the summer, we had a couple sessions that were focused on specific repertoire. And of course, this past fall, we've been focused on the foray. But the structure for those were very different, very different. So as you know, in the summer, we focused on 3 rehearsals as part of an exploration of certain repertoire. One being the 4th and 5th movements of Brahms' Requiem, only 2 movements. And then spirituals from Tippett's Child of Our Time. And that featured a couple guest artists focused on vocal technique, overview of styles and how the music is completely different, warm-ups and sectionals or whatnot. But when we look at the fall, we did something completely different. We said, look, in the fall, we normally have something like 15 rehearsals. And so we decided to tackle a larger work, obviously the Foray Requiem that we're doing today, which has 7 movements, you know, and we had many more guest artists. We did some ear training with warm-ups. We did overview of style and of course the French repertoire and how the French repertoire changes how we technically approach certain works. So that's a little bit of how they're very different, because like I said, the summer was really focused on a couple movements that signified or at the heart of the work we're looking at, but there are only 3 rehearsals. We didn't even know how long rehearsals might be. You know, obviously on Zoom, it's a little harder to have a 3-hour rehearsal. And, you know, during the normal year, we actually have around 2 hours and 45 minutes or something like that. It's very different. And the fall, we went to a more traditional rehearsal style with that 15 rehearsals with 7 movements. And we thought maybe like 3 rehearsals per movement, but then we started doubling up. And so towards the end, we started repeating some of the things and overviewing them. So in the spring semester, what we're going to be doing is changing a little bit about the elements based on feedback that many of you provided. And this is Ariana Stahl, who sang the Mozart Requiem. It's actually in Germany, I think, right now, but is a wonderful singer, wonderful soprano. And of course, what repertoire we're going to be looking at. And I think a lot of people might be really interested in that, obviously, because we haven't had a chance to talk about what that might look like. So the elements, more people, we're going to start a little bit how we do our normal rehearsals. We're going to have a little bit of a break during the holiday season and start back up on January 25th. And so that is approximately like 4.5 weeks from now or whatnot. A lot of the comments were that they wanted to focus more on singing and have more time in sectionals. And I got a lot of nice comments about Julia and Paul alike. And so I think it'd be really fun to actually focus on repertoire that might actually be a little bit harder, but spend more time in sectionals so that there's a little bit more basis for that. Everybody loved the guest artists, whether they're doing performances or clinicians. And I think we're going to do that a little bit as well. Also have some vocal technique like we did during the summer, a little bit more warm-ups and some sight singing and ear training or whatnot, but limited because I think that people, there's so many different levels of people of comfort level for that, that it was harder to hit a level that a lot of people were engaged in. Sometimes people thought it was way too easy. Some people thought it was way too hard. Some people thought it was great, but the overall comment was that people wanted to have a little less of theory and a little bit more singing. So I think that's how we're gonna change things for the spring. Now, the important part is the repertoire. And as we talked about a little bit last week, I mentioned that because we are normally a symphonic chorus, a chorus that is 230 people, it's hard to sing a cappella works like that. You know, we're not chamber chorus of 16 people. We have roughly like 190, 180 people singing performances at the same time. And we do things with orchestra. So it doesn't make necessarily sense to have one half without orchestra, then the second half with orchestra, because it's not economically feasible. And so the repertoire that we do tends to be a repertoire that falls within a certain genre. Well, a very specific genre, that's symphonic choral repertoire. And that of course has a lot of requiems, a lot of oratorios, larger works, and works that are composed with an orchestra in mind. However, this presents an opportunity for us, especially because we're virtually and we don't have accompaniment or, I realized that they kept, my family kept the Christmas sounds on. So hold on just one second. Hey, Google, stop. Okay, sorry. So it was in my mind when I'm trying to listen, think about the music we're going to do. So we can actually do different repertoire that is geared towards a cappella singing or sparse accompaniment. So we likewise will have approximately 15 rehearsals during the spring semester. We're going to be looking at completely new works. All of these composers are living. Morten Lauritsen, of course, as you know, is from Southern California, but also Frank Celli is also from USC. Daniel Elder is the youngest. He is born in 1986, if you can imagine that. Eric Whitaker, if you don't know that name, is the hottest name in choral singing, and I'm going to play some of these works. Tina Anderson, Abbey Rhodes, the studio, wanted to have an anniversary, 80-year anniversary, and they commissioned works from all over the world. And she was the one that won with this piece, The Angel. And Charlotte Bray, Agnus Dei, which is a fantastic, fantastic work. Again, they're a composer. So that's a little bit of what we're gonna be doing. We're gonna be focusing on them in a little bit longer than the summer, but shorter than the spring, focusing on a couple works at a time, connecting them. But I wanna play some of these because these are some of my favorite works of all time. And they are really, really just stunningly gorgeous. So I'm going to see if I can do, let's do Eric Whitaker. Eric Whitaker, this is a piece called The Seal Lullaby. And this is a work that he wrote for a movie. It was when he first was starting out, and Morten Lauritsen and some others were really encouraging him. And this wasn't that long ago. And this is a work that, let me make sure that I get share computer sound. This is a work that was composed for a movie. And then he called the movie studios like over and over again. He's just like, I haven't heard back from anything. What are you going to be doing? It's supposed to be this really touching movie that he wrote this lullaby for about a parent and a child. And they said, and they finally got back to him and said, oh, nobody told you. We actually decided to go with Kung Fu Panda instead of your movie. And so this never got used in a movie. And it eventually became a movement in one of his albums, a track in one of his albums. And it is a really lovely work. Let me play it a little bit now. Beautiful. Let me try to see if I can do more volume. So that's one of the works that we're looking at. Another one is this piece, like I said, by Daniel Elder, Ballad to the Moon. And this is, Daniel Elder is quite young. I'm going to try to turn up the sound a little bit, but this is a piece, Ballad to the Moon. Another gorgeous work, it's those are really, really beautiful pieces. The Omani Mysterium of Morten Lauritzen is actually an older work, and it is from obviously one of the greatest choral composers as well. But we played the Dir Edhon of Morten Lauritzen, and this is an a cappella work of 7 minutes. And it is utterly gorgeous with amazing chords in it. another utterly gorgeous work, as well. And then I want to play just a little bit of Tina Anderson's The Angel. And this is one I only have actually MP3, so I hope this actually works. I wonder if I can do this.
Yeah, you go share screen, and then at the top of the screen, the advanced tab, and just share sound. Oh, I see it, unless it's not a local file. It's working.
I think the sound is a little funny, but it's a much more searching and yearning work. And so it's not just a, sorry, the baby's crying quite a bit. It's not just the beautiful, delicate chords all the time. I also want to say that Lauritsen's really cool. There's no sharps or flats in it, except for two notes. And that happens on one word, the Virgin. But in any case, I think it's going to be a really fun rehearsal process and getting to know these works and getting to know what the difficulties are in singing works like this, because all these composers are generally doing English or Latin. You know, in terms of using the words and how they feel in our mouth and the poetry of the works are absolutely just gorgeous. So that's a little bit about what we're going to be doing. I want to start with a warm-up. Let's have everybody standing up. And so what we're going to do is just turn at the waist. Oh. And what I want you to do is roll your shoulders around, roll your neck around. And then put your thumb in your belly button. We're going to breathe into our belly like we're Santa and go, oh, oh, oh. And everybody, oh, oh, oh. And then what you want to do is really feel it guttural, like you're really, really moving that bowl full of jelly, right? Oh, 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 right? Let's do that again. Ready? And oh, oh, oh. And then what we're going to do is we're going to do a sigh. Let's do a sigh. And we're going to put again our thumb in our belly button. And we're going to breathe in and then out on shh. As if you're a sleigh going across the snow on the ground, or if you want to think of it like you know, like the bells that are going shh, shh. So let's just pulse that continuously. So if you run out of breath, just start over again. And shh, 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 shh. So what I want to do is I want to do that again. But I want you to think about using as little air as possible, but still maintaining the same amount of kick. So don't close off the amount of airflow here. Control it. Control it, just like a balloon that we control the top where it comes out, how much air comes out. But you want to have the same kicks. Because we don't want to lose too much air while we do and support. Ready? And good. Okay. Let's do another sigh. Anew. Take a really close look or feel of your jaw. Really open it up. Yawn. And feel how the contour of your jaw dips in. And then the same thing, your jaw doesn't go down, it goes down and in. Get your tongue out of the way. So you can see that's in the way, out of the way. And you have a mirror with your Zoom camera. So if you want to go look, you're really looking for the tongue to be really down and you can see the darkness, not not getting in the way. Because remember, your tongue is a muscle, it's flesh, it absorbs sound, and we don't want that to happen. We want the bones, we want the bones of your jaw, the hard places of your face and your skull to be reflecting sound, okay? So let's do some consonants now, activate the kick, and then apply them to some sounds, not just sounds. So we're gonna really nice and slow to articulate every single one. And not bad. This time I want you to do it one more time and put both hands on your belly. Do you see how much they're actually moving in? We can actually do focus on this. I can do it, watch this. That's only using my mouth. And so we really want to get full movement here, okay? Let's try it again. And. Okay, now I'm gonna go to the piano, but stay standing. Walk a little bit to make sure that you're light on your toes. And what we're gonna do is we're gonna hum a little bit. Where I want you to go. Pretend you're a deer eating carrots at the on the roof, and you're going, mmm. So you go, mmm. What you wanna do is really sort of have a nice, easy vocalization of your entire range. It's like a sigh, except we're vocalizing with a closed apparatus. Mmm. And then what we're gonna do is, we're gonna do a Hark the Herald Angels Sing, but only on humming. Actually, let's move down. So we're gonna go. On nice hums. Here we go. Right. Actually, let's move it up a little bit. Right here. Ready? One, two, and up. Trying to do this in various keys. Same thing again, but this time, no, 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 na, 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 na. So new at the beginning, and then when you open up, go to na, na, na. But again, forward sounded, no, 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 na, na, na. And really engage the voice, but don't go, no, no, don't go backwards, but no, 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 forward in the sound. Let's go backwards. Here we go. And. On and practice this. That's great. Okay, so let's do the next one is ni vu 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 ni vu. Okay, I don't think that was me. Maybe it was me. I don't know. Okay, let's try this. Ni vu ni vu ni. So start on ni vu 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 ni. You're gonna end on ni. How about that? And up. Ni vu ni vu ni. Wait. What was I doing? A different song? Oh, Christmas tree. Yeah. Okay, Christmas tree. Sorry. And up. Ni vu ni vu ni vu ni vu. Twister, and there's only two syllables. Ni vu 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 ni. And it's harder to do when I'm trying to think of things. Okay, let's do. Okay. For a complete legato, on new already, right? And. That's what it is. Okay. No, 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 no. Same thing. Go from ooh to ah. Okay. I want to do a different key. Okay. Here we go. One and ah. No, no, no. Here we go. Now new key. And new. No, 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 no. Chords. Why can't I get two chords? That was great. That's perfectly fine. And last exercise on da. Joy to the world in da. Da 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 da. Okay, let's do it. Ready? One, two, one, da. Really open up. Da 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 da. What I want you to think about is supporting the notes as you go down. So we're not going to go da 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 da, but you're going to keep that energy for the entire time. Da 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 da. And then let's just do that phrase, and then we'll go up the scale. Let's go down a bit. Okay, here we go. Da 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 with heavy energy. One, two, and da. Da 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 da. Quite a frenetic look at all the Christmas carols, but let's take a sigh. And I'm going to go back to myself for a gallery because I love seeing all the decorations. And if you're wearing Christmas sweaters or you're wearing hats, I see Jared is wearing antlers. That's absolutely fantastic. But what we're going to be doing is we're going to be going through the various movements of the foray. We're going to be interjecting them with some fun things. And we come across a couple trivia things along the way. So the first trivia question for you, you can make guesses, is I want you to guess how many holiday cookies I baked in December. And the answers could be one of the following. So put in your guesses. You can write it in. We didn't do a poll, but feel free to put your guesses in. Some of you are very optimistic. Wow, a lot of people saying 300, bunch of 100. Some people said 44. Yeah, that's true. That wasn't one of the numbers, but it's potentially. And 500. So the answer for this trivia question is 146. And so I made a few dozen. That's 12 dozen basically is 144 plus the extras. And the girls just made some today. They made some really fun ones with a lot of different decorations. But okay, so what we're gonna do now is we're gonna read through a little bit of the foray, singing along. And then we're gonna do some Christmas holiday songs with Paul. We're gonna have some more trivia questions along the way. Actually, why don't we do one more? Why don't we do one with Julia? So the Julia question, how about this? I'm gonna post it in the chat and then read it. Ooh. But Julia double majored in undergrad. Besides music, what was her second major? Now in music, there's only one major. Others are minors. And then of course we have augmented. So maybe this was an augmented. And this is not a trick question. It is one of those. Poli-sci is fun. I suddenly love politics again. French, Francais. My favorite thing is Violet when we went to France when she was very young. She had a chocolate croissant for the first time. And so she learned how to say it. She was like, pain au chocolat. I want pain au chocolat. It was accusing. But the answer is psychology. She was a psychology major as well as music in undergrad. Okay, great. So now it's time to bring out your scores. We're going to start at the very beginning with the foray. And speaking of French, we're going to look at the foray and the first movement. Now remember, the first movement has a very slow opening. And I don't even know how long that first note is because there is no conductor. But I'm going to try to conduct along. And you can try to follow me. And let's see if I can pull this up. Movement one. I found out the sound, you know what? Let me stop the share first because let me just make sure that I have all the correct things. The sound is better, unfortunately, with the sharing the QuickTime player. So I'm gonna do that, but conduct with the smaller box. So hopefully that works. Okay, here we go. So with the music, Fauré's Requiem, a lighter Requiem next to the camp, next to the fireplace. Here we go. Thank you. Oh, such a beautiful movement. Such a beautiful movement. Such beautiful painting, as we've talked about many times. I'm going to hand it over to Julia, who's going to conduct a second movement. So, Julia, take it away.
Awesome. Hello. Good evening. Okay. Sorry, I was muted. So, hello.
I muted you somehow. I was trying to mute myself, and I muted you. Sorry about that.
Okay, that's okay. Hello. So I'm going to do the same thing that Ming did, which is share the QuickTime video instead of sharing my sound. I know that my sound wasn't great last time I did, so I will monitor the chat to see if the sound works this time. So here we go. Okay. Stop it, but I hear that the music is tinny and bad quality. Is everyone feeling that? Wait, one moment. Maybe let me try to share again and let me bring the tracker back a little bit so that we can start back up. But let me see if I can share my sound in a different way.
And Julia, before you do, check that you haven't got any other applications taking up processor time on your computer.
Okay. I do have Chrome. Let me quit that.
Okay.
Let's try this now. Okay. I will try the same thing maybe with Chrome off. Okay. It's not the worst. Okay. So I'm seeing that maybe it's not the worst sound, so it can at least be sung through maybe until the end on the same quality. Is that what it sounds like for most? Okay. I see thumbs up. Great. Okay. So in the case that it's not perfect this time around, we'll keep going. Okay. Sorry to pause it. Okay, here we go. I'll bring it back just a little bit so we can get into it. Thank you. Okay, I still saw some comments about bad sound quality, so I really apologize for that. But I did see a lot of people still singing along, and so I felt bad cutting it off in the middle of that, depending on varying sound quality. But I'll see if there's anything I can do to change that. But in the meantime, I will pass it back to Ming.
Great. You know, the static was especially heavy in the last part. Why don't we sing that last part, starting from bar 77 to the end, and it'll be a nice compromise right there. So 77 to the end. And so, oops, you can't see me. Oh, there I am. Okay, voila. And so I'm going to try Gabrielle Fauré recording, best recording. Let's see if this one works. So this is the bar 77, I believe. We'll see how this works. Here we go. Let's continue with the third movement, and then Paul's going to take over after the third movement. Paul, you're doing the fifth movement, right? I think Paul's doing the fifth movement. So let's do the third movement, continuing on with the Sanctus. I'm going to continue the same recording.
Thank you.
Oh, that's such a gorgeous work. Such a gorgeous work. It's really, really absolutely wonderful, wonderful work. Okay, so now we're going to do something a little fun. You know, Paul, as an accompanist, obviously has not had as much interaction because he has only been helping out with sectionals because obviously we're not having rehearsals where we're accompanying. So we decided to feature him a little bit for today's rehearsal, and he's going to lead us through a couple of holiday carols and songs. So, Paul, I'm going to turn it over to you.
All right, thanks, Ming. Here, let me put myself on speaker view. Okay, can you all hear me? Can you hear me okay? Okay, this is a little hint as to what we're gonna be singing first, get you all in the mood, because, you know, if you're not lucky enough to live in a place where it snows all the time, we're not gonna, you know, you don't have any snow. So, if Christian will put up the score for Let It Snow, we'll get started with that. And there it is. So this is such a short song, folks. We're gonna do it twice all the way through. And I would take that opportunity in the second time through to try out some harmonies. You know, if you're a soprano and you're sick of singing melody all the time, maybe you try a harmony underneath it. And I'm gonna alter the end just a little bit, and I'm sure you'll stay with me on it. So here we go, Let It Snow, and. Oh, the weather outside is frightful, but the fire is so delightful. But since we've no place to go, let it snow, let it snow, let it snow. It doesn't show signs of stopping, but at to turn way down the road. Let it snow, let it snow, let it snow. When we finally kiss goodnight, now we will only know in the summer. But if you really hold me tight, all the way home I'll be warm. The fire is slowly dying, and my dear, we're still goodbying. But as long as you love me, so there's one song, and you know, I had another song that I was gonna save for later. It would be our last song because it, you know, it's a little slower, but you know, I have another choice for our final song. So right now we're gonna go to Have Yourself a Merry Little Christmas, and Christian has that. We're just gonna do this one time because, you know, it's pretty short.
We'll sing it for Boris Johnson.
Okay, there we go. Okay, I'm gonna give you just a little intro, and. Thank you. Merry Christmas.
Paul, that's great. You know, in honor of Paul, why don't we actually have a little question about Paul. There is one false statement of the four statements I'm going to put here. And this is something to see if you know about Paul. Find the false statement. There is one of these statements that is false. Paul does not have a bachelor's degree in music, or Paul did not really understand compound meter until after high school. Do we really understand compound meter? Is that something that people really understand? Paul was once a laboratory supervisor for Campbell Soup Company. That's fantastic. Paul began teaching himself piano at age 5. So one of these is not true. Actually, don't remember which one is not true, and I have to look it up. And so I'm going to guess, let me see. I'm going to guess C. I'm going to guess C. Let's see. Let's see. How about that? So taught himself at 5. Yeah, you know, there are people that Beethoven, when he saw the piano, he said it just made sense to him. And he just ended up playing it. Maybe Paul is Beethoven. That's a supermaster as well. So let's see. Let me look up the answer. And the answer is, oh my goodness. I only see 3 people that got this right. No, 4. 4. The false statement is Paul did not teach himself piano at age 5. So, Paul, what was it? Did you start teaching yourself piano at age 3?
Actually, I required instruction, and not until age 7.
So, wrong on both accounts. You did not teach yourself. It was a wrong age, but you were a laboratory supervisor for Campbell's Soup
Company. That's right. That's right.
My father, his first job was working at the Dole Pineapple Plant. And I was always jealous. I thought that was much better. My first job was in high school. I was a butcher, which is the stupidest profession for a pianist to have when you're sitting there like cutting meat and everything. It's just like the worst possible thing. But what is your undergrad in?
My undergrad was in food science.
Oh, fantastic.
And so, I had a minor in music, and right out of college, that was me in at the Sacramento tomato plant.
That's fantastic. Now this is the biggest question of all, and everybody can raise their hands too if they feel the same way. Do you feel like you understand mixed meter, compound meter, or compound meter? I had this. Somebody had posted online. I did something in 1216 and it started to make sense until it didn't. So, compound meter, quite difficult. How about let's do one more? Let's do another one. This one is Paul studied collaborative piano at which school? So, I almost printed the answer. Is it University of Hawaii, which is a very fine school because everybody's so relaxed there? UC Santa Barbara, which is a fantastic school as well. Down south, a lot of good wine, though they shouldn't be having wine, right? Then Eastman School of Music, which is also a fantastic school. And then San Francisco Conservatory. Who put that there? Just kidding. That's also a very fine school as well. Anybody have a guess for which one this one? Collaborative piano means that your focus is in chamber music, accompanying singers. It's part of any works that you actually collaborate with others. And so they often do a lot of chamber music. They allow to do voice or instrumental accompanying and whatnot. And as you know, from the many years that we've had accompanists over the years and auditions and whatnot, it's actually a really hard thing. It's a skill set that you definitely have to develop. And we love Paul and very much miss having him as a collaborative pianist, but love having him, obviously, there's a few songs too, and all this stuff, because I had no idea of this either. But the correct answer is Eastman, which is wonderful. So Eastman, you should be used to the snow as well there too, right?
Very much.
Yeah. That's great. Eastman's a wonderful school. Okay, so we are going to move on. We're going to have a little bit of a break, not a break, but a break where we listen to, or you can feel free to sing along to the PA Jesu, the fourth movement of the 4-hour. And this is a movement, of course, that's for soprano solo or boy soprano solo. But it is often an audition, an audition piece for sopranos. So if you are a soprano, when you decide your audition pieces, unlike instrumental auditions, vocalists get to choose a repertoire they can sing. So when they pick a piece, they have to decide, why am I picking this piece? What do I want to show off? So for the PA Yezu, think about what you think are the main characteristics, what makes it difficult, and what allows people to show off aspects of their voice through this piece. So let's go through. Paul, I'm going to remove your spotlight for now, only for now. But I'm going to go back and share Gabriel Fauré's Requiem, the best recording. If you see it says complete, best recording. So how could you deny it being the best recording? So let's do the PA Yezu, fourth movement. Feel free to sing along or just listen to, let's say, if you want to just listen along, listen analytically and say, if I were to try to identify the strengths of the singer or the weaknesses, what would I think? So here is the PA Yezu. I'm not going to conduct this one because it's straightforward. Okay.
Thank you.
Oh, that's gorgeous. Yeah, so just like Jared and Ruth, Cherries and Jared mentioned, what are the things that you would pick out are the difficulties of this piece, or what are the things that you would want to try to show off in your particular voice? Yeah, definitely breath and phrasing control, dynamic range. I oftentimes think of precise pitch is definitely an excellent one because it's so slow that you can't not be on pitch. That's a warning. I mean, like, it's very evident when you're not on pitch. And the breath support to maintain the beautiful tone is incredibly difficult. There is nowhere to hide your voice in that, you know. And as we talked about, French music has a certain style and color to it. And if you have a wide range of colors that sort of goes all over the place, it's not necessarily a good thing, right? But you need to show the dynamic range while still having the control over color. And then you have to have pitch, you know, your intonation needs to be correct. You need to have beautiful phrasing and good breath control to make sure that tone doesn't change. You know, it's actually a deceptively difficult piece. You know, it's the same thing that we've been talking about all these pieces. Like, the foray sounds so lovely at first instance, but what makes it a great piece is the further you go down, the more you find amazing things in it. The craft is amazing, and the difficulties of making it a beautiful work incredible. So what we're going to do now is I want to do a little bit, maintaining that sort of dolce tone and that intimacy, because that, you know, like, that intimacy is a construct, right? You're singing to like 4,000 people or 500 people or whatnot, and yet to try to maintain that sort of intimate tone is a matter of color of your voice and the way you approach it. And sometimes people think about sort of a very resonant sound to try to maintain sort of ping. Any case, what I'd love to do is I'm going to take spotlight off. We're going to take a small break before, not a small break, but another little break before Paul starts conducting the fifth movement. But what I want to do is go into gallery, and for my sake, I would love to take a picture, a screenshot of everybody with some sort of holiday thing, either. And if you don't have something in your room or somewhere close by, maybe a happy face or whatnot, I'm going to remove my spotlight so we can go to gallery. But I would love holiday things. I have my I'm gonna have a holiday drink here with fake poinsettias. I'm gonna go to the tree. So feel free. This is moment. Oh yes, I see Paul with a hat. Oh, that's great. I see more holiday hats. I always see a fantastic hat that looks like it's a spring. Oh, that's really wonderful. Okay, so what I want to do is I'm gonna try to take some screenshots, and it would be great to have this all. And I wonder how I'm going to try to say this. Everybody smile. I'm going to go through all six of these. See, that's one of them. And then, like, you can hear the camera take it. Oh, my goodness. It's so great to see everybody. And then, of course, yeah, you don't have them. You just smile. Or you can make a silly face or whatnot. Okay, here. This is three of six. It's right here. Oh, look at that. I love the amount of it. I am disappointed that I don't have antlers in this house. Of all people, I should have antlers. Oh, I love the background. Oh, some really cool background with pictures and stuffed animals and whatnot. Okay, and there's some people are mastering Zoom's editions and whatnot. I see a flamingo. And see, that's great. I see homemade antlers too. And then I'm going to go do this last page right here. And there we go. Okay, so thank you very much for indulging me. I have to go find myself in this mess right now. Okay, so let's do a couple more just trivia things, just because this is really fun for me to find out, so I hope you indulge me. Julia, how about this? This is a question about Julia. Oh, I might know the answer to this one before. I am drinking, I am drinking Armagnac. Armagnac is a cousin of cognac. It is actually the oldest eau de vie. It's the oldest spirit in Europe. And it is an absolutely beautiful thing. It's like cognac, except it has more grapes in it, and it's only singly distilled. It's not doubly distilled. But today is National Armagnac Day, and December 21st is National Armagnac Day, and I'm the one that made it National Armagnac Day. So if you go on Instagram or you follow Facebook or see me on Facebook or whatnot, the Armagnac Society in France, They said, thank you to Ming Luke for instituting Armagnac Day. And all these major houses like Labote are like, thank you, Ming. We have no clue who you are, but thank you for creating this holiday. So not only is the Christmas star out today, the Saturn plus Jupiter, not only is it Armagnac Day, but it's also, you know, like the shortest day of the longest year in the world, right? This has been the longest year, but it's also a time for all of us to get together. And so thank you for indulging me for, of course, those pictures and all your festive, wonderful faces. So I'm going to turn it over to Paul, and Paul is going to lead us through the fifth movement. So Paul, take it away. I'm going to mute.
Okay, now I practiced this with Christian earlier today, so bear with me for a sec while I get this up. It's probably gonna start and I'm not gonna be conducting yet, but I'll catch up. And if you don't hear the music, please let me know. And here we go.
Thank you.
Beautiful. Fantastic. Beautiful work, beautiful conducting. You know, I'm going to say something that sounds like an insult at first, but listen to the second sentence. You know, it's funny because the motions of hand conducting are actually quite relatively simple. But what's actually really hard is connecting to the music and really having sort of the idea of phrasing and color. And that comes across really, really nicely in the way that you approach the music. And so beautifully done, Paul. Thank you so much. So we'll see Paul in a little bit. We're going to read through the sixth movement with Julia. And this is going to be the sixth movement, then the seventh movement with me. But of course, this is, again, with the second movement, those two movements were added later. So the baritone solos didn't exist, if you remember. And if we went through the movement that Paul just conducted into the last movement, it makes absolutely wonderful sense. And if you add the sixth movement to it, it completely changes the color. So let's try, Julia, all yours, and we'll do the Libera Me.
Okay, thank you. I wonder too, Ming, I'm gonna see if the sound will work this time, but if not, instead of singing through the whole thing, I might wanna pass it back to you if the sound quality is bad. So we'll see. Okay, let me share. Let me see, okay. Hopefully it works this time. Can everyone give me thumbs? We'll just listen to the first. Sorry, I meant to say, we'll listen to the first part of it first for a little bit, and everyone just give me thumbs up or thumbs down for sound quality, just for the first couple of phrases to see how it's going, and then we'll see what to do. Okay, I'll press play. Yay! Okay, so it sounds like, it looks like mostly thumbs up. That's great. Okay, we'll start back at the beginning. Time to sing this time. Please sing with the bass solo, if you please. Okay, here we go.
Thank you.
Okay, I hope that was better this time for the sound.
I think the sound sounded much better from my point of view. I think that, you know, it is an amazing, you know, I forgot who it was, but there's this comic that was saying that, you know, some of the technologies that we have, like he was talking about the fact that people are complaining about being in airplanes. This is obviously before COVID, but he said, hold on a second, let me pull myself back. Okay, great. He said, you know, we're hurtling through the air at like thousands of, like hundreds of miles per hour. And it's something that's like, you know, like nowadays we take for granted. But, you know, it's really hard with Zoom because if you think about it, like the dynamics for this, I mean, like we have over 100 people on Zoom. I don't know how that works, but it's absolutely, it's amazing. But I'm sure there's always issues that arise. Okay, but let's be at peace. Let's do the in paradisum. And so be thou in paradise, be thou in peace, and hopefully be thou in good sound. And so what we're going to do is we're going to go on to the seventh movement. And then as always, sometimes I actually see you waiting for your specific voice part. But remember that if you wanted to be a soprano and you're not normally a soprano, you can start singing at the beginning. You can do whatever you want, you know. Or you can do what Paul suggested during some of the Christmas song, sing-along, is to actually sing harmony. See what that's like. What if you decided you want to augment foray? You know, would there be a major or minor issue? It wouldn't. Would it diminish his music to augment the music itself? So, okay, here we go. Let's do the seventh movement. Let me actually find the seventh movement. And I love how the person who created this video online on YouTube didn't actually put in titles for the last movements. Enter your cast here, starring. Okay, starring all of you. In paradise, in the stars, in the sky.
Thank you.
And of course, remember that one of my favorite parts that I'm missing about live performance is at the end of pieces like this, where the audience doesn't want to be the first one to applaud, and they just let it sit, and the sound just goes, and then as a conductor, you're like, I'm not going to move my arms down, because if I move my arms down, the tension's going to break, and you try to do it as slowly as possible. But it's those little things about performance that we miss quite a bit. So this has obviously been a wonderful time exploring the foray over the course of this semester. And it is a glorious, glorious work, and I'm glad we had a chance to sort of do it in more depth. What we want to do is, I believe that we want to show off, actually. David Flack has been experimenting with Jamulus, which is a way for people to actually perform together in distant places. And the technology, I don't know anything about the technology, but they've been exploring it. And so they actually have a recording of a few singers singing together as a demonstration. So David, I'm actually going to pass this to you, and you can take it from there to let us know what Jamulus is like.
Okay, thank you, Ming. So it's not just me that has been exploring ways that we can sing together in times when we can't actually be in the same place. It's the entire virtual music committee, which is about 10 people. We've been working for a couple of months to figure out ways that we can sing together in real time while we have to be remote. If you've ever tried to sing Happy Birthday on Zoom, you know that this just does not work on Zoom. Everything is so out of sync, it's a complete disaster. But we're exploring other technologies that will allow us to do this. Let me share my screen here. And I'll be playing a very short clip, just about 45 seconds. Most of the virtual music committee wanted to be on this recording, but we just had scheduling problems. And so it turned out that there's only four of us who are on this particular recording. It's Ellen Rosenfield and Ignacio Dairit and Lisa Nelbach and me on this recording of Silent Night, which we're singing as Lulu instead of words. And as I said, several of the other committee members wanted to be there, but it just didn't work out from a schedule perspective. So this was all recorded live. There's no post-production stitching together to make sure that everybody's in sync. This is what happened in real time. And so this is what it sounds like. Said no stitching, just that was recorded in real time. So we're going to be exploring this more over the break between terms here, and we will be sending out emails to the singers list and get more of you involved. And our goal is to have it so that anyone in the chorus who wants to can sing together in quartets or octets, or probably anywhere between 2 and 20 people. This probably is not, we don't know for sure yet, but this particular technology is not going to work for 230 people in the whole chorus. It doesn't scale quite that well. And it also won't work if you want to sing simultaneously with your friends in New York. That's not going to work. It's too far. You need to be within 100 or 200 miles because with the technology, we can eliminate a lot of the latency, but we can't alter the speed of light. So it's just not going to work if you're trying to sing simultaneously with somebody in New York. So like I say, we'll be reaching out to folks. And if you would like to be able to participate in this, we welcome you joining this effort. That's it.
Wonderful. Thank you, David, so much. It's really wonderful. Just want to ask a couple questions while you're still there.
Several
people just want to verify you can hear each other when you're singing, right? You can actually hear everybody else, right?
What you heard in the recording just now is what we heard while we were singing.
Got it. That's fantastic.
You can hear everybody in real time.
And then, can you see each other?
No, this is audio only. A lot of folks who use this technology also fire up a Zoom session and kill the audio in Zoom. They mute everybody in the Zoom session and they run all the audio over Jamulus. And if you do that, you'll see that the video in Zoom is not in sync, but still it could sometimes be helpful to be able to see people even if you're not relying on that for synchronization.
Wonderful. Thank you, David, so much. That's really, really wonderful. Thank you. And the rest of the virtual music committee. Wonderful to have everybody really exploring this, because a lot of this stuff, as people can imagine, is being developed, you know, just trying to adjust to nowadays. And so this technology is very new, not only for the people exploring it, but the people creating it too. So it's wonderful to have a team of us exploring what might work for people that are still obviously searching for ways for us to really connect more. So thank you again, all of you. That's wonderful. Great. I'm going to change. Okay, so now Paul is going to lead us in, I think, one more sing-along song for all of us for the last bits of this rehearsal of the year. This is, we're going to look upon 2020 with 2020 hindsight, you know. And so it's, you know, I had all these jokes actually ready last year, because I said 2020, we're going to look back with such clarity into what the year was. And I had no idea it was going to be like this at all. But it's already being, you know, I have orchestras and ensembles that are starting to schedule performances, you know. And so I'll tell you a story after we do a sing-along. But Paul, I'm going to pass it along to you.
Okay, thanks. As I said earlier, I had a particular song that I wanted to do for our ending piece today. Normally you'd want to do something like Silent Night or whatever, something like that. But I thought, given that what we're going through this year in 2020, that we could sing Blue Christmas together, because I have so many people that I would love to be seeing right now and over the next week or so. And we just can't do that. And this song, I really feel, expresses what I'm feeling about this. I know if you look at the score, you'll see there's a Christian, that's not up just yet. But if you look at the score here, there's a woman in a chair thinking of her guy, and there's a guy thinking of his gal. And, you know, I'm thinking about family and friends, and I just miss them all. So let's sing this together. And let's give it a try. Here we go. And I'll have a blue Christmas without you. I'll be so I don't intend to really have a blue Christmas so much, but I hope you all have a nice one. Okay. All right.
There you go. Thank you, Paul. Oh, absolutely wonderful. You know, I want to thank everybody, especially Paul and Julia, of course, for being stalwart people on the music staff. Just absolutely wonderful for the year. Sorry, hold on a second. Great. And then, of course, I want to thank everybody on the board, especially Christian, for all the technological managing for this semester. And so, again, do sign up for next year. Next year already, 2021. It's going to be a really wonderful season, I think, looking at a lot of these incredibly beautiful works that are some of them very familiar, some of them very new. And even if you don't know, let's say, Eric Whitaker, he's one of the most important choral conductors today. And he's new within the last, like, you know, 15, 20 years or something like that, you know. And Lauritsen's a little bit older than that. But, you know, people like Daniel, I forgot what his last name is, Elliot, I think. But is absolutely, you know, incredible talents coming through. Like I mentioned, I'll just tell you this one story because I want to let people know too. But I'm making my San Francisco Symphony debut in January. And it's a Chinese American, you know, it's a Chinese New Year concert that they're taping beforehand. But typical of the Bay Area, they said, you know, just note that there are very few musicians on stage. You know, we have no winds, no brass. We can't have that because they just, you know, spell so much, you know, air, and it goes around everywhere. And so, you know, the ensemble might be as small as 8 people, you know, maybe 10 people, but we need a conductor, and, you know, like, you're Chinese, so fine, you know, that works, right? And then I have a concert with Houston Symphony in a month, and they said the same thing. They're like, you know, just let you know that because of COVID, we have to be really careful about our numbers, and we have to make adjustments because of the orchestration. So we just want to let you know that there can only be 40 people on stage. So it's not going to be full winds and brass, only partial winds and brass. And I thought it couldn't be more like Bay Area versus Texas versus, you know, it's just amazing. But I just, you know, it just made me thankful for being where we are together. Because this is such a momentous year. I'm starting taxes already, and it's one of those things where I love to do because I look back at all the things that I did over the year and I said, look, this is wonderful. I remember that concert. I remember these people. But when we look back a little further, like 5 years from now, when we hope that the vaccines are there and we're back to normalcy, the people that we shared this year with are going to be with us forever, right? This year is such an incredible year. And the fact that we get to do the foray and that we meet every single Monday and have our normal routine is really important to me. There are many musicians where their entire schedules got decimated, and to have regularity, to have community, I think is one of the most important things. And it's one of the function of music, right, is to build community, connection with each other. And so that being said, it's like an absolute treasure, obviously, and privilege, obviously, to share not only music, but our time together, especially during now when time doesn't feel like it makes sense anymore. So I want to thank all of you and for coming each Monday, and feel free to make the family bigger, but please join us next semester with these incredible works as we explore them and we continue to tinker around on the best way to keep us all engaged. But with that, feel free to unmute and say, you know, season's greetings and everything, but thank you all. And so this is the start of the days getting longer, and maybe the start of things becoming more open and available. And I'm glad to have shared this time with all of you. So happy holidays, happy new year. I'm gonna take the spotlight off me, but feel free to unmute, stay around for a little while. And yeah.
Tomorrow is 2 seconds longer.
Excellent.
That's the beginning of spring.
Nora.
Hello.
Hi.
Hi there.
Did they send you?
Cases
of Armagnac from France?
They did not send me cases of Armagnac. I would have loved it, but if you think of cognac as being like the flashy, you know, marketed thing, Armagnac is exactly the opposite. Armagnac are just like these small farmers that have plots of land. Armagnac is a city, as a town, is tiny.
Yeah.
You know, and they show the facilities, and it looks like they're still from the 1800s. I mean, like, it's just just a bunch of people getting together. And, you know, the thing is that it just, it has the same, it's the same grapes. It's really, really just, it's sort of a more bold cognac. So, you know, if cognac is really light and bourbon is really heavy and viscous, Armagnac is kind of in between. So for me, I like it. Yes, everybody have a toast, whatever you're drinking.
Yes.
My family all loves eggnog. Eggnog is really
salut.
I trust we're each getting a package of your cookies.
No, the reason why they're really, like, we didn't go for a volume this year because I tried these things called window cookies. I guess they're just jam tarts or whatnot. But it's like these really minuscule cookies that are this big, but they're so fussy. You're cutting out these like little things out of, and every single batch takes like 20 minutes to do the top, and then 20 minutes to do the bottom, and then 20 minutes to put the jam inside and everything. Oh. But they're so gorgeous, you know? So I made a bunch of batches of those and then probably ate them all, so.
Good health, continued good health to everyone.
Yes,
yes.
Good health, everyone.
Thanks, everyone.
Yeah. Yeah,
right.
Thanks for being here.
Bye.
Veronica, I didn't get a chance to say hello on Saturday at the Messiah thing, but I saw you there. It was great to see you.
I could only take 45 minutes of it because it just didn't feel right to be singing all by myself.
Well, better, you know, as the French say, faute de mieux, for lack of anything better.
Right.
That's what we got.
Let me tell all of you, if you didn't watch Ofer's thing that was in Chorus Notes today,
beautiful. It was
watch
awesome.
It. It's really wonderful. The artist who does the work, the whole thing is absolutely lovely. 1 hour. It's still available on their YouTube channel. So follow the link in our Chorus Notes and take an hour to watch and listen. It's really quite lovely.
I watched it too, Veronica. And it's just amazing.
Yes.
Right, thanks, Veronica. I'm going to, I think it's up until January 6th.
Yes, that's right. Yeah. So you have a lot of time, but take some time to watch it.
Merry Christmas, everyone. Good night, everybody.
Merry Christmas.
Good night.
Bye.
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 Thank you, Julia.
I was here with you.
Thank you.
Bye.
See you in January.
Bye.
Things will be better.
Yeah. Happy holidays.
Vaccine coming. Vaccine is coming.
Yeah.
It was a new president.
Most of you are in the 1B group, which is coming shortly.
Yes,
look it up on CDC.
As long as they send it to the state of California and don't just wish us all into the sea.
Right.
Yeah. A new president is coming.
That's right.
Yes.
Ooh, yes. Reason to be hopeful.
Yes.
There's
new
hope.
Days.
Uh-huh.
Watch the
bye.
We're happy again.
Yes. Yeah. Okay. Thank you.
Bye.
Thank
good
you.
Night,
bye bye.
Good night. Good night.
See you in January.
Bye. See you in January.
What's the matter?
Where's Veronica?
Still there.
Anne's shirt says, "I'm not dead yet."
Well, that's my festive shirt. You know, it's a Monty Python. We made it this far.
Great.
Merry Christmas. Happy holidays, everyone.
Yes. Merry Christmas.
Yeah. You know.
Humbug. Who watched the planets tonight?
We love you, Arnold.
Yes. Watch them right now.
I've been watching.